Mr. Paul May.
Hello, brother.
Just like my side, I'm not just like
You cried out for help from the Savior, and you know you can't give Yeah, oh, that's at 10 o'clock on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, okay? So, anyway, it's good to see the crowd we have this morning. This is our second service back since things have been going the way they've been going. And so, I'm honored. I'm blessed. And good crowd today. And Parker's going to be getting baptized today. Excited about that.
Amen.
Parker Rose, where's she at? Where's she at? Come here just a minute, Parker, if you would. Amen. Now, a lot of you didn't know this, but our first service back since this pandemic, Parker came to me after service. Mom brought her up here to me. And God was dealing with her heart during the service.
Amen.
And, boy, you know what she did? She just wept her way to God.
Amen.
Amen.
Like the song said, her heart just awoke the master. Amen.
Amen.
And I'm glad for that. So, Parker, you accepted Christ as your Savior. You meant that with all your heart. Right. You gave your life to Him.
Yes.
You're going to follow the Lord and believe in baptism. Today we have the baptism ready. We're excited about the first service back. You're going to get saved. Amen.
Amen.
Parker, you're going to be saved.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. We'll make your mom or daddy come up here and sing a special in a minute. But anyway. It is an honor to be here today, and I'm thankful always to be in the house of the Lord, to have a time to worship with us. Together like this, as of right now, we're doing this at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. And we'll stay with that for a little while until we see things kind of changing. And as we do, then we'll kind of change our format and try to fill out and try to continue to open doors and meet more needs as we go along down the road. And then on Wednesdays, for this week, we're going to open up Wednesday evening services at 6 o'clock. And so it's our Bible study, prayer meeting, Bible study time. And so we was involved. Before this pandemic, in a doctrinal study, we'd gone way down the road on Bible doctrine, and so we've been doing that, and so we've been having a great time on doing that. And then sometimes we'll just have testimony service, a breakout, and have something else going on, and just whatever the Holy Spirit kind of leads us to do is what we want to be involved with. And so it's good to see Boots back today.
Amen.
And so are you doing good? No crutches, no.
No crutches.
No crutches or anything. Are you fishing again?
I did go fishing.
See? Getting back into full swing. And so anyway, we are doing the service live again. And things like this for those that are home. We love you at home. We appreciate you. And so when you're comfortable, we want you to come back. And maybe there are some that I know that are off a good distance or out of state and they've been watching. And we do appreciate that so very much. Lord's been good to us. Amen. Somebody's been complaining the other day, said, boy, things are so bad here. Everything's so bad. I said, you know what? We need to talk about something that's been good going on around here. And there has been some things. Just a little girl getting saved, that blessed my heart. Now, I would hate to imagine we missed the service when the Holy Ghost wanted to deal with her about getting saved, and she got saved and gave her life to Christ. That's not something this church can do, by the way. That's not something this preacher can do, by the way. It takes the Spirit of God to awaken the heart of the person. To bring them to a place that they can trust Christ as their personal Savior. And so somebody says, well, how hard is it? What do you got to do to get saved? I really believe that's the wrong question. I believe that, friend, what we absolutely do is nothing. What we do, if we do anything, is we throw our hands up in the air and we say, I surrender.
Amen.
I give up the wicked person that I am. I admit it. I'm rotten to the core. There's no good thing in me. I deserve hell. Hell should be my home one day. But thank God, Lord went to hell for me. He gave Himself on a cross, died for me, and because He shed His rich red royal blood, I could be saved. Well, I'm about to shout. But anyway, I'm not even trying to preach here. Let me get back over here. I told somebody today, they said, Brother Kevin, if I have to get up, it's because the seat in the back has had some problems there. And I said, if I have to get, don't take anything personal about it. I said, look, don't worry about it. I'm not preaching on that. They laughed. Daniel, that's not very funny, but they did laugh. And so, but I am working on that. We love you today. We appreciate all that you are and what you mean to us. And so, you can tell folks, we're trying to practice respectful distancing is what we call it. Okay? Just be respectful. And try to give people room. And some people, everybody feels a little different. So let's just be respectful. Amen.
Right.
Now let's honor people's requests and wishes for this stuff. And that's where we ought to be. Don't make fun of anybody. We're not here to do that. We're just here to worship the Lord. It's not about a big thing. It's not a you thing. and we just ought to worship the Lord. Amen? And be thankful for that. I want to say real quick, I appreciate all the work that's going on in the building. If some of you before this, you noticed it was one color and things were different, and now things are different now. And I appreciate all the men and the women and all those that have been involved in the redoing the sanctuary, and now we're involved with the kitchen in the back. I want to say a big thank you. Give the Lord a clap of praise. We have the place freshened up, amen, and going again. And we're thankful for that. So people have been asking about the mission sale. It'll be around the 1st of August, I believe, is what we're scheduling for. And so hopefully that's safe enough time to where we can go ahead and have our mission sale that we do every year. We'll make note of that again. I have an announcement here on Sunday, May 24th at 6 o'clock in the evening. Grace Connection graduation is going to be going on. And there's three kindergartners, Zoe, Alana, Sadie Kate, and then one pre-K, Anna Clay, right? Did I do that right? All right. So we'll not have a reception due to social distancing situations, but they didn't want to end the year without celebrating these sweet girls and the efforts they've had in school. And so they will be doing that for those who would like to come participate, be a part of that celebration with Grace Connection. And so be mindful of that. And though I think I've got all the announcements, let me say this. Anybody have a birthday within the past 2 months? We hadn't done it. We're going to tell you. Anybody have a birthday in the past 2 months?
Can I say something?
Okay.
Yes. I want to thank my church family for praying for my sister. And when those clocks broke loose, it went to her brain. I said,
yeah.
She's gone.
Yeah.
She's gone. God proved me wrong.
Amen.
He's still the great physician.
Amen.
And thank you for your prayers, and you'll never know how much y'all mean to me.
Amen.
I love you
with
all of my heart.
Glory.
Thank you. Glory. My sister's doing fine, by the way.
Doing fine. That's good words. Good to have my dad and my mom here this morning. And I had Kim, my sister, she joined who? Betty? What's wrong with Betty?
I never stand up.
Oh, birthday.
Hey, in the past 2 months, if you got a birthday, you got to stand up.
I forgot I had one.
All right, if you can remember that far back. All right, if you had one, stand up. Come on. There you go. Brother Jimmy Dale, tell us he had a praise too. Listen here, Jimmy Dale had a praise too. Tell us, Jimmy Dale, you just had a test done. They was waiting for results, and they found out it was benign, right? And so we're thankful for that. Amen. And that's always a scary thing. Amen. And it's good to be in the house of the Lord. So let's sing happy birthday to him, okay? Anybody else? All right? If you didn't have a birthday, you want to sing to you, we'll do it. No, we won't do it. All right. But anyway, let's sing happy birthday to him.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. And happy birthday to you.
Amen. You may be seated, except for those that had an anniversary. Brother Bill, there you go. Let's stand up. Now, how many years? 23 years. Smooth. Easy. Nowhere near. A storm. What word describes? Oh, no, never mind. Okay. Brother Bill Fernandez. We love you guys. Happy anniversary to you. Anybody else have an anniversary? Nobody. Yes. Yes. Come on, tell me. Brother Ken, do you know how many years? Can you hear me?
41.
41 years. Hallelujah. God bless her. She's a good woman. Give her a clap of praise. All right, brother. How many years? 22 years, great years, wonderful years.
Yep.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Yep. He's trained well, boy, he's trained well. Hey, Brother Paul Winder, 25 years.
Amen.
That's good, amen. And so thankful for that, and boy, the Lord's been good. It's been, feel like every time we get together now, it's just, it feels like a family reunion more than a worship service, trying to catch up with some people and see field folks, and pray that the pews continue to pack out and fill up for the glory of God. Not for our sake. We're not in competition with anybody, folks. We're just going to honor God. Amen. That's all it is. Give the word of God out. It's nothing complicated about that. Just do what God said. Yes, sister.
They had an anniversary.
Oh, they did. How many years, brother John?
39.
39 years. Give them a hand.
I thought July 10th would be 100 years.
Okay. All right. 100 years. All right. Amen. That's a century. All right. Let me see. Anybody else? Anniversary? Any other celebration? Anniversary? How many years? 16 years. Anybody is that old?
Amen.
16 years. Been good years, hasn't it? I don't know what's wrong with folks. I'm going to have to quit asking that question. But anyway, get a little too personal, I guess. Love you. Congratulations to you. 16 years. Give them a clap of praise. Amen. What a testimony that is. Anybody else have an anniversary before I overlook anybody else? Anyway, I'll tell you what. We're just going to stop it right there. We could go on. I've got to do this. Girls, come on back. Sing that song one more time. If you have to cancel a hymnal, I mean, we're going to do our offer. We're not going to forget the offer. Don't worry about that. I can see it in your eyes. I can tell you're fretting over that, but we will do the offer for you. Okay? So don't worry about that. I'd like to ask, would it be okay if they sing that song?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
I've got Holly going to sing right before. I didn't give her a whole lot of notice, to be honest with you, but I texted her this morning. I said, would you please sing for me this morning? She said yes, and so she's going to do that right before I preach, but I tell you, I think every time they sing it, they get better, but just the song just blesses my heart. And me and my wife was talking about that, and love to hear these girls singing that song. So, girls, if you do that.
The disciples were getting concerned.
stand?
We'll do an off-door song this morning. Amen. 404, 405, have faith in God.
Children, have faith in God.
his throne, he's going to look and say he's not guilty.
Yeah.
He's been paid for. His debt's been paid through the righteousness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm innocent concerning that, and I'm thankful that the blood covers it all.
Yeah.
I'm glad there's not some things that I've done so bad that he says I'm not going to be able to handle that for you. You're going to have to work that off. You're going to have to do something for me, or you're going to have to give something to me, or you're going to have to do something in order to work the rest of your situation off. I'm so glad to report today there's not one sin that God did not cover with his blood when he saved my wretched soul. I thank God every thought, every action, every deed, every thought I ever had in my life that was sinful, or that was wicked, or that was intrusive against the law, the will of God. Today I'm glad to report that it's been washed clean.
Amen.
There ain't nothing left there. And somebody says, well, I'm going to see what your past is. The only person who ever wants to bring your past up is the devil.
That's right.
That's the only one that ever wants to bring your past up, friend. If you're defeated by your past, you need to get more excited about your future. Amen?
Amen.
We need to let folks know how God's working and what God's doing in this day and time. There was a woman that was J. Vernon McGee's, but one of his books he was talking about. There was a woman one time that was begging her husband to get saved, to know the Lord as the Savior, just begging. And said, preacher, I have begged him. Matter of fact, every morning at breakfast, I go to tears begging him. I'm weeping at the breakfast table and begging him, going to tears. Please get saved. Please get saved. You don't understand. I'm praying for you. Please get saved. And then at supper time, said, oh, preacher, I give it to him at supper time. And I'm just to the point of weeping after I talk about it for so long, begging him to get saved and just weeping for him to get saved. And she said, he thought about that. Old J. Vernon McGee said he left it. Left the woman there. And then after a while, he got to thinking about that. He said, you know what? I'd hate to be married to that woman. Said, I'm doggone if every time she's talking to me about the Lord, she's weeping and she's a-crying and she's a-boo-hooing and she's one of them weeping Christians. And I'd sure hate to be married to that woman. Every time I ate breakfast and every time I ate supper, I had to hear that same old weeping and same old begging and same old pleading. He said the next time he seen the lady, he said, ma'am, he said, I'll tell you what to do about your situation. I prayed, thought about it. He says, I want you to quit. I want you to quit begging him, and I want you to quit sitting at the table. He said, she said, you mean you want me to quit witnessing? Sound like a spiritual Pharisee, doesn't it? You want me to quit witnessing? Said, no, ma'am, I just want you to witness in a different way. Said, a matter of fact, I don't want you weeping over him no more like that in front of him. I don't want you to quit begging him at the breakfast table and at the supper table. Said, a matter of fact, I want you to just start having some joy about you and showing what it's like to be saved. Amen?
Amen.
And I'll tell you what, sometimes we just need to get a lot of joy about us so folks will understand what Jesus means to us and they'll want some of it. I believe a lot of folks are passing by the church house today. You want to know why? Because there's no joy going on. People aren't excited about what God's doing. You ever passed by? Remember, it was in Philadelphia. Was passing by the stadium. Somebody must have just hit a home run in that big stadium there at the Professional Park, and they knocked a home run. We was out there working on the boat. Somebody must have knocked one out of the park. And we was coming around the thing. I think it was me and Matt Cody. And we was coming around then. Boy, I'm telling you what, it sounded like the place. We weren't even inside yet. It sounded like the place exploded. I mean, hey, you could hear it cheering. It was a big old deal and everything in the world. And we got inside, found out somebody hit a home run or something. And I was, matter of fact, we was walking in about that time. And I thought about that. I said, well, wouldn't it be nice whenever I'm reading the Word of God, we finish and everybody stand up and say, yeah, hallelujah. And the place would erupt. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, man. Oh, man. I can see right now you're going to make me work for my money today. Nehemiah chapter 13. Okay. Let's give that a shot. Amen. Nehemiah chapter 13. You can get over to chapter 8 and work your way up to that. Of course, you start off with Nehemiah. What a man of God. Boy, you got to love Nehemiah. I mean, he's a lady. He's not even the preacher. I mean, he's not the priest. He's not the guy. God used him. He had a broken heart to rebuild the wall and have the temple thing to clear it. And to care for the things of God. What a man of God he was.
Amen.
Got to love a man of God like that. I mean, he wasn't the preacher. He wasn't the guy that should have been leading that kind of stuff. I mean, he worked in the house of the prince. He had another job over in Shushan. I mean, he wasn't the guy of the day. And yet God had in that man, that layman's heart, to go do what God had told him to do and to watch over the temple. I mean, he had to leave to go to the temple, to go to Jerusalem. He even had to leave Shushan. He had to get a leave of absence where his job was at to go there. Boy, he was excited every time he got to go on one of his visits. This is one of his visits, as a matter of fact, over here in chapter 13. And he's going back to Jerusalem. He's going back to see the temple. He's going back to see the people he loves. Last time he was there, they were doing a dedication service. He had gotten together all of the preachers. This was a hallelujah service. One of them wall banging, everybody's having a good time kind of deal. I mean, spirits high. Everybody's feeling good about God, who they are, dedicated to the Lord. And they was having some kind of service there. And, several years before, somewhere between chapter 12 and chapter 13, doesn't really describe, but he had to leave, and he had been gone about 2 years. And he was away somewhat about, and so he's away, and he's fixing to go back. But when he was left there, there was a massive choir they had gotten together. A massive choir. And the instruments were brought together for the dedication. And every service in the temple, there was a huge celebration taking on. And they were honoring God, and they were thanking the Lord, and they were just giving God the glory for all the things he was doing there. And it was an amazing event. He leaves. 2 years later, he's going back here. Let's see what happens. Quite a different situation. I'm thinking about the pandemic that we've been involved with here. You know what that is. I had to look that up. Pandemic. It means an incident to a whole people. That's what it means. And it's kind of an epidemic, you know, a virus or something like this. But it means something that affects the whole people. All of the people. Think about that for just a moment. We've never seen it on this occasion in our world or our lifetime. My dad, they've never seen it in their life. Their grandparents never seen anything like this in their lifetime. There's been plagues and different things in certain areas, but not the whole world covered in a certain time and running somewhat in fear and involved with a pandemic where the whole people have to be influenced or involved in that. I say, dear friend, listen, a lot of people have a different opinion about this, and I'm not here to give you my opinion today, but before I move on, I just want to digress and say this a minute. Wherever you stand on this virus thing, whether you think it's a political hoax, or whether you think folks have, and I believe it's a real virus, people are getting affected, and it's a serious situation. I think at the same time it's been blown way out of the water above other sicknesses and other diseases that we're dealing with on a day-to-day basis, that people are dying with on a day-to-day basis. There's more people, babies being aborted right now than are dying with an epidemic.
Amen.
You do know that, don't you?
Amen.
Some of that stimulus money was forced to go over to Planned Parenthood, and they're aborting babies by the hundreds of thousands.
Amen.
And yet we're concerned. Well, I understand. I'm not trying to be a bully about this thing. I'm not trying to give my opinion, understand. But I do want to tell you just a moment before I get out of that this morning. I do believe we need to have a good understanding of this thing. I say that, dear friend, before we should be afraid of a virus, we ought to be serious about it, because there's always been a sinful pandemic. The whole world has been affected by sin. Every one of us, dear friend, you was born into sin. The Bible says, in my mother's womb I was conceived. A sin. In your mother's womb, you was conceived in the book of Psalms. How is that happened like that? I've never cursed and never said I was in my mother's womb. I tell you, because you carry the same nature that Adam carried, and it's a sinful nature.
Amen.
If you're awake before you say your first curse word or you commit your first sin, listen, you were a sinner before you ever acted upon it. We're all sinners. There's a pandemic of sin. Amen. Bible says, for all have sinned.
Yeah,
ain't one of us. Ain't one of us. Including me, number one. Don't you ever let a preacher tell you that after you get saved that there's no more sin. Listen, as long as you wear these meat skins, you're going to have sin around your life. And you're going to have a battle every day dealing with it. You're going to win some and you're going to lose some. Might as well get the face of it. Amen? And no sense in me lying about it. Might as well get the face of it. Chapter 13. God help us. Let's go read that. I told you it's going to be short this morning. I'm blowing that already. Help me, Jesus. Help me. Chapter 13, verse number 1. On that day, they read in the book of Moses and the audits of the people, and therein was found written that the Ammonite and the Moabite should not come into the congregation of God forever, because they met not the children of Israel,
with the bread, with water, and hired Balaam against them. You'll find that over in Numbers chapter 23 and 24, the story of Balaam and how they told him. And you'll find that over there. And he says, and he hired Balaam against them that he should curse them. Howbeit our God turned the curse into a blessing. Isn't that the way God works?
Yeah.
You know, this thing may feel like a curse. There's some people that have lost family through this. Dear, precious people have died through this virus.
Right.
People have suffered loss with this virus. No matter how you feel about it, people have died with it. And it's been a pandemic all over our world. And just to think about that, but isn't it good to know that something that seems to be such a curse, and somebody says, well, this has got to be of the devil. You better be careful about that.
Amen.
Because I don't believe the devil can do one thing God won't allow him. To do. Somebody said, I don't believe that. Well, you don't believe God's over all then.
Amen.
Really and truly, the devil is nothing but a puppet on the string. God uses that. He's used even wicked people to correct God's people because they've gotten disobedient against him. God do that today too.
Amen.
Amen. He raises kings and sets kings up and he takes them down. He raises nations up and he tears them down. All for his glory. All for his purpose now.
Amen.
That's where we're at today. And so we're reminded of that in this reading. And we're talking about, but God took something and made a blessing out of it. And then notice what happened. He said in verse 3, now it came to pass when they had heard the law that they separated from Israel all the mixed up multitude. All the mixed multitude. So somewhere between chapter 12 and 13, there was Nehemiah had returned to his job in the palace of Shushan. And remember that he had been there. To leave, he had to ask for some kind of absence, leave of absence maybe. But he had been back in Persia for a while. And maybe a year or two, whatever it was, I don't know. But he made a shocking discovery. And the people were not keeping the separation that they should have been keeping real. Now these Jews, Israel was not to mix in their marriage with the Moabites. They were not to have anything to do with that. All that says to us, dear friend, those Jews had a whole different set of law and world than we did with. You have to really get into the mind of God why he did that to those Jews. Because he came to his own and they received him not. So he plagued them just about with a whole set of bunch of rules. It was really confusing. Matter of fact, we preachers still scratch our head today trying to figure out some of this stuff. How their laws went and how come they had to do it this way and how come they had to do it that way and what to eat and what not to eat and what to when to go. And they had to be Sabbath keepers, we find out here. They had to not mix in their marriage with certain kinds of people and things to keep their bloodline that way. That's what God did to them because they would not trust him. Later on, he knew he'd reject. And so God did that to them because of their refusal, their disobedience. And we're reminded here that he made a shocking discovery when he came back to Jerusalem this time. The people were not keeping the separation that they should have. Now we're talking about 6-foot distancing. God says, you're not to be in contact with them. You're not only to marry them, but you're not to be influenced by them because they were easily influenced. Listen to me, dear child of God. All that says to us in our world, Gentiles, listen to me. It's just saying to you and I, that dear friends, we need to be disconnected, separated, sanctified is the word in the Bible uses, that we ought to be separated from the worldly crowd.
Amen.
We ought not have nothing to do with it. We don't belong to it. We ought to run from it. We ought not watch it. We ought not listen to it. We ought not look at it. We ought not take part in it. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
We ought not take part in it. We ought not participate in that trash. And I'm telling you, that's what's wrong with us today, is that we're too invested. We've gone backwards. We've not gone forwards. And we're finding out what's going on this day. Now in 1 through 3 there, we find that Balaam, he can be found in Numbers 23 and 24. The Israelites read the account. They decided this thing was to obey. They needed to obey God, but they were failing again. They had mixed in their marriage with the Ammonites, the Moabites, and those folks, and the children of Israel realized that they must. Now, verse number 4. And before this, Elisha, the priest, having an oversight of the chamber of the house of our God, was allied unto Tobiah. You better watch it. Here we go again. He's taken the very one and fixed to set him up in a place in the temple. Bad, bad, bad. It's bad today that the church is not coming more like Christ. It's becoming and looking more like the world.
That's right.
And there was another hit against them. Oh, I mean, here is the high priest through the marriage of his son or daughter. I don't know, but the marriage through his son or daughter was allied in the house of Tobiah. And the high priest himself was disobeyed God in the important matter of separation. And God strictly forbid the matter, and yet here goes the preacher putting him in a place that he should have never been. In the temple. And then verse number 5. And he prepared for them a great chamber before time, and laid the meat offerings and the frankincense and the vessels and the tithes and the corn and the new wine and the oil, which was commanded to give the Levites and the singers and the porters and the offerings of the priest. And so what we see here is that the priest had turned over the temple storage room to Tobiah. He turned it over to him. He said, you just move in here. You just, whenever you come down, why don't you just hang out here? You can have all this you want. And they quit giving to the choir. They quit helping the families that were involved with the choir. They quit helping the men of God and the workers of the temple of the church and stuff. And you know what they had to do when they got stopped getting paid to get cared for their needs? They had to go back to the field and start working to make a living. I mean, the house of God had been forsaken. What a shame it is. What a pandemic it is. What a mindset it is when the whole thing is affected and the choir's gone. I mean, Nehemiah lost his choir. He comes back. The choir's not there. The house of God's been forsaken. Tobiah is laying up in the back room, married to somebody he ought not be married to. All this thing is a mess. It's a mess. You gotta love it with old Nehemiah. If you don't know Nehemiah, he's all about revival.
Amen.
I think most folks got revival mixed up real bad. They think revival is about seeing folks get saved. I like it the way my father-in-law used to say it all the time. He says, you know what? You want to see God, you want to see lost people get saved? He says, you can't see lost people get saved and drag them over a bunch of dead Christians.
Amen.
Once God's people get alive, and once God's people get revived, you see some folks get saved. Amen?
Amen.
And so who wants to see folks get saved? Now, who doesn't want to see folks get saved? Amen?
Amen.
But Christians are going to have to wake up, get some joy about them, get some excitement about them, love what God's doing in their life. Stay focused not on CNN, not on Fox News, but stay focused on the Lord on this thing. Don't let the virus scare you half to death. Live a little bit by faith. Trust God. Put your faith out there. Let it be tested just a little bit. Hey, listen, it's not bad to be a little daring, amen, and to live by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't act like we're going to live forever because we ain't going to do it. We ain't going to do it. We've already been told, and we've already buried a lot of our loved ones. And I can't wait till I get to go home. I was listening to Mackenzie this morning out of the house, and they're going home. There's a going home day for me, amen? Now I'm looking forward to that day. Well, we just go on, and I'm running out of time. And I say that with all due respect. You know, I'll pray for 3 hours if I need to. And I get on that in India, and on that site sometime, he'll tell me, he said, okay, Brother Kevin, you just preach as long as you want to preach. I love that guy. Everything's gone. You see it? Everything's gone. There's a whole lot missing in our churches today, by the way. We may not have a choir, but I believe a lot of people's song is gone. I believe we've also lost our identity. I think we've been more infiltrated. We've been more involved with who we are than who Christ is, and because of that, we get our same self in the same self shape as what we find Israel in here. They got a place to worship, but nobody to go worship. Their identity has been lost. They have begun to focus. They're giving. The giving of themselves, the giving of the money, the giving of all these things in the temple, it was gone. They had to go back to the field and work. We've lost our identity. We lose our song. When we lose our ability to give ourselves. Money's just a part of it, folks. Everybody gets hard and scared to death when I'm preaching mentioning money. Money, 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 money. Hey, that scares you, don't it? Oh, Lord, here he goes. Ain't gonna talk about money. No, I'm not.
But it wouldn't be nothing wrong to do it on the Word of God. Money's a big part of it because he knows that influences us as Christians a lot. Our money that we make ought to be to honor God with first. And then whatever's left, we'll do what we need to do with it accordingly. Amen? That's what we ought to do anyway. Amen? It's not about my money, your money. It ain't your money. It ain't my money. Thank God you have breath enough to go make it.
Amen.
Be faithful to God with it. Amen?
Amen.
You want more of it? Be faithful to God with what you got and he'll get you more of it.
That's right.
Amen? God's going to want to get you more of it whenever you're faithful to what you already have. Amen? And by the way, God doesn't want every Christian driving around in a Rolls Royce. Amen? We shouldn't ride around. It's not meant for God's people, every one of us, to ride around in a Rolls Royce. It's not meant for that. Or a Beamer, or whatever you like. For our redneck boys around here, a Z71 Chevrolet or something like that. But anyway, it's not meant that way. You understand what I mean? I'm telling you, they lost their identity. They lost their song. Choir was gone. The people gone. The Bible said the house of God has been forsaken. And I want to close out with this because I believe this was an important part of that in these little verses right here. It's in verse 14. Remember me, O my God, concerning this, and wipe not out my good deeds that I have done for the house of my God and for the offices thereof. He says, in other words, Nehemiah saying, remember me, O my God, concerning this. Man, he went in there and told Tobiah to get out, packed his bag, took his suitcase, chucked it out the window, and he says, you're out of here, bud. Your day for freeloading is gone. What do you mean? You're out of here. And he didn't just do that. He went in and just fumigated the place. He said, I'm tired of this trash. This doesn't belong here. This belongs here. This is supposed to be over here. And this is supposed to be here. And he says, I want you to go find the folks that sang the choir. Because I came to hear some singing. And I came to hear the Word of God. And I came here to raise my heart and my hands up to worship him and to have some joy and some fellowship. And he says, the place is a disarray and things must change and go back to being what God said they ought to be.
Amen.
And matter of fact, we're so important in his prayer. Boy, Nehemiah was a praying man. This book opens up with a prayer and it finishes off with a prayer, but he's a praying man. He says, remember me, this is in a prayer, oh my God, concerning this, and wipe not out my good deed that I have done for the house of my God and for that. He says, Lord, would you record this? And he did. He did. He recorded it so we can read it today. He recorded it. And then he says in the last verse number 22, and I commanded the Levites that thou should cleanse themselves and that they should come and keep the gates to sanctify the Sabbath day. Remember me. I mean, there was the folks coming in and they were observing to observe the Sabbath and they weren't doing it. They were coming in on the market in the gates and they were selling on the weekend during the Sabbath. Now, somebody says, well, man, Brother Kendall, we got to keep the Sabbath. No, we don't keep the Sabbath. We're not Sabbath worshipers. We're Christ worshipers.
Amen.
We don't have a day. Every day is a day the Lord has made. We're to rejoice. He's the God of not just the weekend. He's an everyday God.
Amen.
And we're to worship now since he died on the cross. The veil of the temple was rent. Dear friend, there's no more entering in and shedding of blood of goats and bulls and doves and turtles. Hey, dear friend, Jesus shed his blood and that was enough for you. Amen.
Amen.
It'll always be enough. Thank God today that whenever we take a look at that, we know what Jesus has done for us. And they were coming back up on the weekend. I could see old Nehemiah standing up on that wall. And here they come. He ordered them to shut the gates on the weekend so they could observe the Sabbath. And they were coming up to the wall with their fish, with their goods. And they're coming in for the party. And he's watching. He's watching. They get closer. These crowds begin to build outside the gate. He told them to shut it. And they built up and he's hollering down there. He says that they've got a crowd. Hey, down there. Read the Bible. He didn't do it just like this, but it'd be something like this. Hey, down there. He said, I see you. He said, I want you boys to go home. You don't belong here. These Israelites, these people right here are to worship and to honor God and to keep the Sabbath. And you're messing with them and you're to leave this place. They showed up again the next week. You know what happened?
He said, I tell you, boys, I asked you to leave once. He said, don't make me come down there. I'll bring a hand against you.
He threatened them. You know what? They never came back again. I believe if you and I would get a little more threatening with what we mean when we say something for the Lord, I believe our life would change too.
Right. Amen.
I'm tired of talking about folks wanting to repent. We ought to go ahead and repent.
Right.
Amen.
There ain't nothing to wait on anymore. Amen?
Right.
I want to ask you, where's she at? Where's she at? Go ahead, Mom. Take her back there. Get ready. Let's all stand up here. Lost his choir. Lost her identity. The house of God has been forsaken. They weren't keeping the Sabbath. That's not for us. That was for them. But that was important for them. They should keep it. They weren't doing what God said. They were eating fish. They weren't to eat it. There were things they were doing they should not be doing. But right, Nehemiah had this thought always. All we need is a revival. He always believed that if God's people would turn to him, God would hear their prayer and heal their land. You know, it was Nehemiah that said, the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Amen.
You need your joy back. You've been out in the world. We smell like the leeks, the garlics, and the onions. We've been influenced by everything in the world except Christ. God help us to return to him today. You've got it in your heart right now. God's dealing with you. Every head back. Maybe there's somebody here today that's lost without Christ. Today, the first time you hear this, and you say, you know what? If I was to die right now, I don't know for sure if I'd go to heaven or not. I don't know where my eternity lies. One thing is for sure, we are going to die. Unless Jesus comes before then, we will go through a physical death. Another thing for sure, these meat skins will stay behind. They'll put them in the ground. Another thing is for sure, one of these days, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Dear friend, there's only two different kinds of people in this world. There's saved people and lost people. You could say there's religious people. But I like to say saved people and lost people. Either you're saved today and on your way to heaven because of what Jesus did at Calvary, or you're lost. You'll never be saved because of who you are and what you do, what you've done. Or matter of fact, you don't go to hell because of what you did, dear friend. You go to hell because of what you don't do. If you don't trust Christ, that'll be the one sin you'll commit against the Holy Ghost of God, dear friend, that you can, he'll never be able to forgive you for. It's not to receive the life of his dear son. And I pray today you know Christ. Say, Brother Kevin, I don't know for sure if I'm saved. And I want to know for sure. Raise your hand. Well, yeah, no one looking around. I'm not here to embarrass anybody. I love you. Not here to embarrass anybody. Say, Brother Kevin, I want to know for sure I'm saved. I don't want a religion. I'm not inviting you to join the church. I'm just saying, I want you to have a relationship with Christ. Say, now, Brother Kevin, I'm saved, but boy, I'm part of that crowd. I've not been separated like all of me. I've not been doing the things all of me doing. And I want that to change in my life. God, give me raise my hand. Raise your hand, I'll pray for you. Help me. Pray for me. Thank you, John. Appreciate it. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Thank you in the back. Appreciate it. Somebody else. Pray for me right now. I'm going to pray for you. Thank you, son. Amen. I want to get that right. Pray that I'll just search that out and ask God to get that right in my heart and my life today. Dear sweet Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for us having the time, God, with you today. Thank you for your precious word and reading of it. Pray, God, that something will happen here today, God, in the heart of somebody, dear God, that they'll have a chance to respond to you. Lord, we do love you. We thank you for your great love for us. In Jesus' name, give me your invitation. Amen. And you'll lead us in one stanza. Let's sing a stanza of this together.
Without him, I couldn't
be nothing. Amen.
Like a ship without a sail.
Sing it here. Jesus died, he was buried, and he rose again.
Amen.
And he lives in Parker, and he lives in me, and he lives in anybody that will ask him to come into their life.
Amen.
He'll have no wise cast you out. Amen. Amen. In the divine command of Christ Jesus our Lord, and upon your professing of faith in him, and I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please stand if you would. Great to see everybody today. Good crowd for the second service back, and we're so thankful for that. Be faithful to your church family. Wherever it's at, it's good to have visitors with us today. We
Amen.
Love you very much and thankful that you came and celebrated. That, I mean, that's more important than going to a ball game and watching that great play ball game.
Amen.
And that was a life-changing decision. It's good to see the family here. We love you very much. Appreciate you. The Lord
Brother Paul Britt, brother, would you close us out with a word of prayer?
I did, God, Father, just come to you today, Lord, saying thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come in your house, Lord, and just worship you, the true and living God. We just thank you for our services today. Thank you for each and everyone that's here today, Lord. We know there's probably lots of needs that need to be met today among our family, Lord, and our guests here today, Lord. We just pray that you meet each need in accordance to your will, Lord. Thank you for this little one that accepted you, Lord, and baptized today, Lord. I pray that you bless her in a mighty way. Find safety from her, Lord. Bless her and her family, Lord. Just draw them closer to each other, closer to you, God. Lord, we just thank you again for being so good to us. Thank you for your safety, Lord. And we ask, as we go our separate ways, that you would just put a hedge of protection about us, Lord, and give us traveling mercies, bring us back at the next appointed time. Lord, we love you and we praise you for all you do. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.